So physical activity not only alleviates depression at or above the rates of antidepressants, but it also heals your brain. If you want to get smarter, maybe not smarter, but if you want your brain to operate better, you should be physically active. You know, the scholar athlete thing you maybe had in high school, where the person was both good at sports and good at athletics and academics. That person really had it going on. The person who never lifted a finger but was really, really smart, long term will not be as effective, because our bodies are designed to support our brain. And the more we move our body, the more it improves our brain.
So let's talk a little bit then about the importance of sports to one culture. We have seen sports all throughout different cultures, all the way back to ancient times. I mean, even like primitive, so-called primitive cultures, such as the some South American civilizations and island tribes have sports. What are some of the benefits to these communities that sports offers?
Well, I think the benefits of sports are what we're seeing in our society. I think we have one up over the Aztecs in our sports, that the losing team is not killed. So that's a plus. But what sports do is they unite people around a kind of entertainment. Watching athletics is a kind of entertainment, that there's a struggle, and human beings love to watch that struggle. And you look at it and you think, okay, this is our capacity as humans, not my capacity personally, but this is what we can aspire to. And I think we all get a great deal of enjoyment of watching the best of people. I like the term glory, and I'm going to define it differently than most people define it. You know, mostly when you think about glory, you think about sparkles or in a spotlight. But a person taught me this definition. Glory is the full expression of a thing. And it's a really important way to define it, the full expression of a thing. So when you see an athlete in his or her prime doing something that none of us, well, very few of us, could ever do, we see the full expression of that human in that activity. And that's glory. And human beings are attracted to both the vile, but, you know, awful things, but we're also drawn to glory. We're the watching the best of something. And the Greek word for that was arete, which means the highest qualities of a thing. And humans love that. I mean, we like that. That's one of the purposes for sports. So we gather around in a communal activity. We historically have put aside our differences to be unified around our allegiance to a team. We watch people do things that we admire, and we have fun. So sports as an observer are great. Sports and athletics in general as a participant are good for us. If we look at physical activity, and we'll distinguish exercise, physical activity, from sports, but there, we'll start with one and then we'll expand it into sports. Exercise reduces depression and anxiety as much or more than antidepressants. So the effect size, which means over lots and lots of people, they'll get the same improvement for mild to moderate depression by exercising, which is free, relative to antidepressants. So you go to the physician's office and they'll immediately prescribe you antidepressants, but they will not prescribe exercise. And I remember talking to this old school psychiatrist. I said, you know, what are you prescribing these days? Which, by the way, is not a good conversation starter. And he said, I never prescribe an antidepressant until the person tells me that they're on a regular physical exercise regimen. because he knew, and this was back in the 1980s, he knew that exercise was as effective as antidepressants. So that's one benefit. The other benefit is, you know, we talk about endorphins. That's just one of the sets of chemicals that your body releases when you're exercising. Naturally occurring endorphins are endogenous morphines. So they're pain relievers, but you get your brain and your body gets a host of other chemicals that get released, one of which is brain-derived neurotrophic factor. And when you exercise to the point of sweating, it releases BDNF, brain-derived neurotrophic factor, into your system, and that's the chemical that grows your brain. It repairs your brain. So physical activity not only alleviates depression at or above the rates of antidepressants, but it also heals your brain. And so if you want to get smarter, maybe not smarter, but if you want your brain to operate better, you should be physically active. You know, the scholar athlete thing, you maybe had in high school where the person was both good at sports and good at athletics and academics. That person really had it going on. The person who never lifted a finger, but was really, really smart, long term will not be as effective because our bodies are designed to support our brain. And the more we move our body, the more it improves our brain.
Yeah.
Now, I know there'll be a lot of blowback on this, and I've gotten it all the time. So what you're saying is, you know, you should stop your antidepressants. No, don't stop it. Talk to your physician about it. But if you're on antidepressants, you should start exercising. And if you're unhappy, if you have mild to moderate depression, exercise is a good first step. Again, I'm not a physician. I'm not saying what's right for any individual. I'm not making specific medical advice because I'm not a physician. But I am talking about what the data show. And the data is pretty robust.
What does it take for someone to be so focused on a singular goal like an Olympian?
It takes a special kind of mindset. There's no lack of physical talent in elite athletes of any kind. That's kind of like table stakes. That's just the entry to the party. But the really exceptional ones are the ones who really work on their mental performance. You know, one of my favorite philosophers and favorite quotes is Yogi Berra. And he said, 90% of baseball is mental, the other half is physical. So not so good on math, but really good at the principle that 90% of athletics is mental. And one of my classmates is now the head of the U.S. Olympic Committee's sports psychology program. And what she does and what her team does is help these athletes to achieve peak mental performance. This is my language. It's not her language. So please don't put anything on her that I've said. But people come to me all the time and they say, well, you know, these are my successful business clients. And they say, well, I'm a little obsessive compulsive. You know, I've got some OCD. And I said, well, you may have OCD. I don't know. But you probably have OCA. So obsessive compulsive disorder is really a problem. And when I did clinical work, it was one of my areas of specialty. I watched people, you know, severely distressed by these obsessive ideas that they couldn't get over with. OCA is the obsessive compulsive advantage. When you have it in the right amounts, being conscientious and being driven and having attention to detail and being deliberate, all of those things make you successful. And so we see these athletes, I think most of them have to have a little bit of the what I call the obsessive compulsive advantage. They're conscientious, they're deliberate, they're really driven to achieve. What sports gives us is all the benefits of exercise plus the benefits of a community. And so if you're part of an athletic team, even if you're in an individual sport, like if you're a golfer or a marathoner, you know, high school cross country, you're still part of a team that trains together, even though your accomplishment is individual. So you gain the benefit of that community of like-minded people. And having that community of like-minded people is a protective against a lot of other problems. So athletics gives you the physical activity plus the community together. They're fantastic.
Do you think here in America, we put a little bit too much emphasis on sports?
No. I mean, I think there's always a subset of people who have a pathological relationship to anything good. But I think the net positive of athletics and sports outweighs the negative. And if you think people in the United States are nuts about sports, that's because you don't follow World Cup soccer or football, as they say in the rest of the world. They're far more rabid in other countries about their national sport. I was in England, and I was in Manchester, and they said, if you're wearing the wrong scarf in Manchester, you could get yourself beat up pretty badly. And make sure, even your clothes were not those colors.
Yep. Sports really lately have been settings for controversy and a lot of politicization, which, yeah, people do not appreciate on either side. Why do you think these have cropped up in our sporting community here in North America? And I mean, how have we allowed them to even become centerpieces on the world stage like we saw at the Olympics this past weekend?
It's all driven by ideology and money. If you gather a collection of people for anything, there will always be people who co-opt that gathering for their own benefit. And sometimes people in positions of power forget their purpose. And really, sports is to entertain and to help people connect. And when they forget that's our job and decide that it should be something else, that's when people feel betrayed. And sometimes the messages are good. So long as those who organize sports remember, hey, our job is to entertain and help people feel connected. That's a valuable enough thing to provide people. It doesn't have to be more than that. That's the job of sports, is to create a good feeling among people. And that's valuable enough. I think anytime someone has an agenda and wants to push it, they will find wherever eyeballs gather. So you'll see it in sports. You'll see it in music. You'll see it in movies. Any of the entertainment disciplines is where you'll see that, because that's where people gather and they want to relax. They want to enjoy themselves. And there are people who think that's not enough. We have to teach, we have to train, we have to inculcate with values.
It's hard to push back in the moment, right? Especially as a crowd. So I feel like some of these groups are taking advantage of the big gathering and implying almost that this big gathering is totally okay with the message that they're pushing, and only receive the backlash later after it's almost, you know, there's not much to do about it.
We see this in sports going back to the 1940s and 1930s. And we'll go to the Olympics in Germany in the 1930s. Hitler was using it as a showcase for his Nazi ideology. And the wonderful thing, and I'm going to talk about, I grew up in Columbus, Ohio. One of our local hometown heroes was Jesse Owens. And I don't know if you know that history, but if you don't, you really should. Jesse Owens was a black man, and he ran for Ohio State, which is my alma mater. And he ran in Germany, and all of the white supremacist Aryan stuff said, he can't be successful. And yet he won. He had this phenomenal performance, and he won which was great for the United States, but also great to disprove the white supremacist ideology. And so we see in sports ways to go against that propaganda. But I guess my larger point is powerful people have always used sports to get an agenda across. We saw it with the Soviets during the Soviet Union and how they used sports to talk about this, the superiority of the Soviet ideology, because they were dominant in so many different sports. We see it all the time as a way to enhance an ideology. We're always going to see it. I think there's been some damage done in the last decade to professional athletics. And I think there's been some damage done to amateur athletics by forgetting if you're in the sports business, you're there to entertain the people who are watching because you do something that is really fantastic. So that's enough.